Hi guys! Hi Zaya, hi Owen. Here I am in Chicago, technically Glenview. Chicago's a big city in the state of Illinois, and I am just to the north of it in a town called Glenview. So I'm going to give you the tour. This is my hotel room. So there we have a nice little living room where I can sit on the couch with my friends. Nice TV if I need to watch something to chill out at the end of the day. Here's a whole kitchen area, so you can sit down and have a meal. I have a refrigerator, and I can do cooking and cleaning and everything. It's kind of exciting to be able to do all that. Nice little table here. And then over here is the bedroom. Again, another TV. A TV in the bedroom? What? I don't like that. And then phone, alarm clock. And then over here is my whole bathroom area. So you can see where I can brush my teeth. And here's a nice toilet and the shower. Got all my clothes hung up. Got my suit. Daddy has to wear a suit. So, I hope you guys are having fun. I went for a nice run this morning and did some exercise, which was nice. Because yesterday all I was doing was sitting around in airports and buses and planes. My legs got itchy, I needed to run around. So, Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. Where do we leave off? Oh yes, remember Harry, there was that little basin with the funny sort of liquid in it. And Harry touched it and he went tumbling inside it into that room. And he was inside of a memory, remember? And Dumbledore was there, and Moody, and Mr. Crouch, and Karkaroff, the head of Durmstrang School. And what did we just learn? We learned that Professor Severus Snape was a Death Eater. But he switched sides. Very well, Karkaroff. Crouch said coldly. You have been of assistance. I wish you will review your case. You will return to Azkaban in the meantime. Mr. Crouch's voice faded. Harry looked around. The dungeon was dissolving, as though it were made of smoke. Everything was fading. He could see only his own body. All else was swirling darkness. And then the dungeon returned. Harry was sitting in a different seat, still on the highest bench, but now to the left side of Mr. Crouch. The atmosphere seemed quite different. Relaxed, even cheerful. The witches and wizards all around the walls were talking to one another, almost as though they were at some sort of sporting event. Harry noticed a witch halfway up the rows of benches opposite. She had short blonde hair, was wearing magenta robes, and was sucking at the end of an acid green quill. It was, unmistakably, a younger Rita Skeeter. Harry looked around. Dumbledore was sitting beside him again, wearing different robes. Mr. Crouch looked more tired and somehow fiercer, gaunter. Harry understood. It was a different memory, a different day, a different trial. The door in the corner opened, and Ludo Bagman walked into the room. This was not, however, a Ludo Bagman gone to seed, but a Ludo Bagman who was clearly at the height of his Quidditch playing fitness. His nose wasn't broken now. He was tall and lean and muscular. Bagman looked nervous as he sat down in the chained chair, but it did not bind him there as if had bound Karkaroff. And Bagman, perhaps taking heart from this, glanced around at the watching crowd, waved at a couple of them, and managed a small smile. Ludo Bagman, you have been brought here in front of the Council of Magical Law to answer charges relating to the activities of the Death Eaters, said Mr. Crouch. We have heard the evidence against you, and you are about to reach our verdict. Do you have anything to add to your testimony before we pronounce judgment? Harry couldn't believe his ears. Ludo Bagman? A Death Eater? Only, said Bagman, smiling awkwardly. Well, I know I've been a bit of an idiot. One or two wizards and witches in the surrounding seats smiled indulgently. Mr. Crouch did not appear to share their feelings. He was staring down at Ludo Bagman with an expression of the utmost severity and dislike. You never spoke a truer word, boy, someone muttered dryly to Dumbledore behind Harry. He looked around and saw Moody sitting there again. If I didn't know he'd always been dim, I'd have said some of those bludgers had been permanently affected his brain. Ludovic Bagman, you are caught passing information to Lord Voldemort's supporters, said Mr. Crouch. For this I suggest a term of imprisonment in Azkaban lasting no less than... But there was an angry outcry from the surrounding benches. Several of the witches and wizards around the walls stood up, shaking their heads, and even their fists, at Mr. Crouch. But I've told you I had no idea, Bagman called earnestly over the crowd's babble, his round blue eyes widening. Not at all. Old Rookwood was a friend of my dad's. Never crossed my mind. He was in with you-know-who. I thought I was collecting information for our side, and Rookwood kept talking about getting me a job in the ministry later on. Once my Quidditch days are over, you know, I mean, I can't keep getting hit by bludgers for the rest of my life, can I? There were titters from the crowd. It will be put to the vote, said Mr. Crouch coldly. He turned to the right-hand side of the dungeon. The jury will please raise their hands, those in favor of imprisonment. Harry looked toward the right-hand side of the dungeon. Not one person raised their hand. Many of the witches and wizards around the walls began to clap. One of the witches on the jury stood up. Yes, barked Crouch. We'd just like to congratulate Mr. Bagman on his splendid performance for England in the Quidditch match against Turkey last Saturday, the witch said breathlessly. Mr. Crouch looked furious. The dungeon was ringing with applause now. Bagman got to his feet and bowed, beaming. Despicable, Mr. Crouch spat at Dumbledore, sitting down as Bagman walked out of the dungeon. Rook would get him a job indeed. The day Ludo Bagman joins us will be a sad day indeed for the ministry. And the dungeon dissolved again. When it had returned, Harry looked around. He and Dumbledore were still sitting beside Mr. Crouch, but the atmosphere could not have been more different. There was total silence, broken only by the dry sobs of a frail, wispy-looking witch in the seat next to Mr. Crouch. She was clutching a handkerchief to her mouth with trembling hands. Harry looked up at Crouch and saw that he looked gaunter and grayer than ever before. A nerve was twitching in his temple. Bring them in, he said, and his voice echoed through the silent dungeon. The door in the corner opened yet again. Six Dementors entered this time, flanking a group of four people. Harry saw the people in the crowd turn to look up at Mr. Crouch. A few of them whispered to one another. The Dementors placed each of the four people in the four chairs with chained arms that now stood on the dungeon floor. There was a thick-set man who stared blankly up at Crouch, a thinner and more nervous-looking man whose eyes were darting around the crowd, a woman with thick, shining hair and heavily hooded eyes who was sitting in the chained chair as though it were a throne, and a boy in his late teens who looked nothing short of petrified. He was shivering, his straw-colored hair all over his face, his freckled skin milk-white. The wispy little witch beside Crouch began to rock backward and forward in her seat, whimpering into her handkerchief. Crouch stood up. He looked down upon the four in front of him, and there was pure hatred in his face. "You have been brought here before the Council of Magical Law," he said clearly, "so that we may pass judgment on you for a crime so heinous." "Father," said the boy with the straw-colored hair, "father, please." "That we have rarely heard of the like of it within this court," said Crouch, speaking more loudly, drowning out his son's voice. "We have heard the evidence against you. The four of you stand accused of capturing an auror, Frank Longbottom, and subjecting him to the Cruciatus Curse, believing him to have knowledge of the present whereabouts of your exiled master, he who must not be named." "Father, I didn't," shrieked the boy in chains below. "I didn't, I swear it, father. Don't send me back to the Dementors." "You are further accused," bellowed Mr. Crouch, "of using the Cruciatus Curse on Frank Longbottom's wife when he would not give you information. You plan to restore he who must not be named to power and to resume the lives of violence you have presumably led while he was strong. I now ask the jury..." "Mother!" screamed the boy below, and the wispy little witch beside Crouch began to sob, rocking backward and forward. "Mother, stop him, mother! I didn't do it! It wasn't me!" "I now ask the jury," shouted Mr. Crouch, "to raise their hands if they believe, as I do, that these crimes deserve a life sentence in Azkaban." In unison, the witches and wizard along the right-hand side of the dungeon raised their hands. The crowd around the walls began to clap as it had for Bagman, their faces full of savage triumph. The boy began to scream. "No, mother, no, I didn't do it, I didn't do it, I didn't know. Don't send me there, don't let him." The Dementors were gliding back into the room. The boy's three companions rose quietly from their seats. The woman with the heavy-lidded eyes looked up at Crouch and called, "The Dark Lord will rise again, Crouch. Throw us into Azkaban. We will wait. He will rise again and will come for us. He will reward us beyond any of his other supporters. We alone were faithful. We alone tried to find him." But the boy was trying to fight off the Dementors, even though Harry could see their cold, draining power starting to affect him. The crowd was jeering, some of them on their feet, as the woman swept out of the dungeon and the boy continued to struggle. "I'm your son," he screamed up at Crouch. "I'm your son." "You are no son of mine," bellowed Mr. Crouch, his eyes bulging suddenly. "I have no son." The wispy witch behind him gave a great gasp and slumped in her seat. She had fainted. Crouch appeared not to have noticed. "Take them away," Crouch roared at the Dementors, spit flying from his mouth. "Take them away and may they rot there." "Father, father, I wasn't involved. No, no, father, please." "I think, Harry, it is time to return to my office," said a quiet voice in Harry's ear. Harry started. He looked around. Then he looked on his other side. There was an Albus Dumbledore sitting on his right, watching Crouch's son being dragged away by the Dementors, and there was an Albus Dumbledore on his left, looking right at him. "Come," said the Dumbledore on his left, and he put his hand under Harry's elbow. Harry felt himself rising into the air, the dungeon dissolved around him. For a moment, it all was blackness. And then he felt as though he had done a slow-motion somersault, suddenly landing flat on his feet in what seemed like the dazzling light of Dumbledore's sunlit office. The stone basin was shimmering in the cabinet in front of him, and Albus Dumbledore was standing beside him. And that's where we'll stop for now. Love you guys. Bye.